All right, good morning, Elkview Baptist family. I'll let it slide this week. We're getting there. We're getting a little better. So, well, if you guys keep an eye on your bulletin, we have a lot going on. I'm just going to bring your attention to just a couple of things today. So, as you know, we have our family fun day this evening for our kids, which also is doubling as our Awana registration. So, please, if you can come out and help with that, let us know. Also, be in prayer for this event this evening and for our start of Awana as we're getting that back up and rolling. Now with that, Awana is going to be starting on September 7th at 6:15. Okay? So it's going to be at 6:15. And so teens, I've already told the teens, so those of you who weren't in Sunday school, we're starting as well at 6:15 on September 7th. And our adult classes will start at 6:30. So they're moving from 7 to 6:30. Teens are moving from 7 to 6:15, and Awana starting back at 6:15. Confused enough yet? Perfect. Okay. Keep an eye on your bulletin. That'll help you. So if you didn't catch what I said, you can read it, and that's a little easier to understand. So Awana teens, 6:15, adults at 6:30, starting on September 7th, the Wednesday right after Labor Day. So that's what we have going on here soon. Be in prayer for our kids and for our teachers and volunteers as we're getting that all back up and running. If you are a guest, welcome. We appreciate you being here and joining us. And there's little welcome cards in the pews in front of you. So if you can fill that out and get it to us after service, drop it in one of the offering plates out back. We'd love to meet you and talk with you and get to know you. All right, with that, let's go ahead and open in prayer. And I'd like to ask you guys to pray with me as we start today, as we pray for our event this evening, as we're reaching to our community, trying to get connected with these kids, and pray for our community and for our start of Awana as we pray this morning. So please join me in prayer this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we humbly come before you, grateful that we have the opportunity to do an event for our community and just offer something fun for our community. But also, Lord, give us opportunities this evening to show your love and share your word with the people who come onto our property. Lord, we pray for the starting of Awana, and Lord, we just pray that you would encourage all the teachers and the volunteers, get them excited and ready, and bring us kids that we can show your love and teach your word to. Lord, we pray that your word would work in the lives of this community and in the kids in this community and would change their lives for eternity. Help us as a church to just be a support to all of our kids' ministries, Awana, Sunday School, Children's Church. Help us to support them and help them as a church so that the teachers and assistants are able to better teach your word and share your love with these kids. Lord, help us be a church that is welcoming and loving to families, and help us show your love to all that come through our doors. Lord, we love you and we thank you, and it's in your Son's precious and holy name we pray. Amen.
Yeah. my soul.
Good morning. Morning. So good to see your smiling faces here this morning. I think of the scripture. I was happy when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. That should be the way we feel every time we get to congregate together as a group of believers. Would you stand with us this morning? We're going to sing a song we sang a couple weeks ago. Hopefully it's getting familiar. Repetition makes for it to get here, right? Hopefully it's in our hearts this morning, for God so loved the world.
Come all you weary, come all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of the water. Sinners. Where your love poured
In Matthew 19, starting verse 13, it says, "Then children were brought to him that he might lay hands on them and pray. The disciples rebuked the people, but Jesus said, 'Let the little children come unto me, and do not hinder them, for as such belongs the kingdom of heaven.' And he laid his hands on them and went away." We have a great opportunities. We have children's church, which I have to get teachers and for. And you can notice in your bulletin, I do need some workers, and that's my pitch. And of course, Awana's with Jamie and Laura heading that up. And you notice too that we have Good News Club starting, with Trudy Fregali in charge of that, and she needs workers also. So we have many, many opportunities to reach our children and of the community, of our family, of our church. And when you reach children, what do you reach? You reach an entire life for Christ. And we need to make that known to these children that Jesus loves them. And so that's my big prayer thing for today. And also we have a few that are recovering and are looking forward to, you know, getting well and feeling better. And also we have some of our missionaries. I don't know if you remember Tim Lee, but he was a Vietnam veteran and was injured and has been in a wheelchair since the 70s. And so he is having some physical problems, and we are, as a church, hopefully going to be giving him some extra money to help him, but he needs our prayers. And of course, we always remember the Koshenkos in Ukraine and what they face every day. So pray for our missionaries, pray for our children. Just pray for those in our church that are not feeling well and recovering, and those who are facing surgery in the future. We just ask your, just to pray. As we see that, you know, a lot of us for our age can't go out there and start working with two-year-olds and expect them to listen to what we want to tell them, but we can pray. And we can pray that God will just speak to their hearts and that the Holy Spirit will convict them of sin and bring them to the cross. So let's pray. Father, thank you that you're a great and mighty God. As we sang these songs this morning, that talked what you did and how Christ came out of the grave. He's alive, and we serve a risen and loving Savior. Lord, that He just loves children. He loves us all so very much. And we need just to spend our time in talking to you, Lord, and let our burdens be brought before you. And Lord, we think of our church as we start the Awana program back. Pray for Jamie and Laura as they head it up and do all that work and is involved there for their leaders and their that they need, and basically we just pray that through it all that they might be able to reach many of our community for the Lord. And Father, we pray for the Sunday school and church time, Lord, as we need some teachers, Lord, and that you will supply, and Father, that we just love the opportunity of telling these children about Christ. Lord, I pray for the Good News Clubs coming up in Pinch Elementary and other places throughout the county where they're going to be involved there with that. Lord, it's just such a good program to reach children of all the ages in school, and just pray that Trudy will get all the helpers she needs, and that this might be a real positive influence in many homes in our community. Lord, we pray for our missionaries. I think of the Koshenkos and all the problems that they face, and for Tim Lee and his physical problems, that you'll help him to get well. And Father, we just pray that this service, as we listen to your word being preached, that we might just draw closer to you and just thank you that we can hear your word and study the Bible. Thank you for all your love for us. In Jesus' name, amen.
To do the same thing for me.
Captives, then you're freeing hearts right now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You touch the lepers, then I feel your touch right now. You are the same God. You are the same God.
That song is a great reminder of the series we're in, Living by Faith, from Hebrews chapter 11. All the names in that song and all the miracles and the acts of faith that God's people went through kind of recalled for us. Thank you, Sounds of Grace. That was a great job. For the last 2 weeks, we've had something special happen here at Elkview Baptist, and I didn't even know about it till this morning. So 2.5 years ago, I had to inform our office staff, don't print 300 bulletins on Sunday mornings. We just have far, far too many bulletins being wasted, cut back to 200. And during the COVID years, that was gracious plenty. So for the last two Sunday mornings, the head ushers come up to me and said, "We're out of bulletins." So that's a good thing. We're going to print a few more bulletins for next week, all right? Isn't that wonderful? All right, so let's just keep that trend going into the fall. And another piece of news, somebody just walked up to me this morning and said, "That's it. I'm out of here. This is my last Sunday." After decades and decades of attendance at Elkview Baptist Church, dear ones that we love so much are moving away. Moving to Scott Depot, and they didn't say, "That's it, I'm out of here." They said, "Pray for me, it's going to be a tough week. We are moving." Carolyn McVeigh and Roy Lean, they are moving to Scott Depot near some family there. But we are going to miss you, sister, in our weekly service. But anyway, God bless you. All right, with our Bibles open to Hebrews 11, let's take a look at Moses' choice. Moses' choice. How many people are mentioned by name in Hebrews 11? I read it again this week, counted each one. There's many allusions to acts of faith, but how many names are mentioned in Hebrews 11? There are 16 people mentioned. And you know something I realized as I read those names, like Gideon, Barak, Samson. These are not perfect people, but these are people of faith. 16 names mentioned in Hebrews 11. That should bless your socks off this morning. They weren't perfect people, but God made note of their life and walk of faith. Take, for example, the imperfections that we are aware of. Noah's faith led him to work diligently and build an ark. Yet on at least one occasion, Noah was depressed and got drunk. He's here in Hebrews 11. Abraham's faith led him to leave home and go to the promised land. Yet on more than one occasion, the fear of man so overcame Abraham that he was compelled to tell lies. Not perfect. Sarah's faith enabled her to bear a child in old age. Yet, initially, she laughed at the angel's prophecy about bearing a child. And now we come to Moses. Moses' faith brought a whole nation out of bondage. And yet, we realize in Noah's history, in Moses' history, there's a very unpleasant day that he killed a man. My goodness. Hebrews 11, why is it written the way it's written? Because it shows us the heart of God. Hebrews 11 doesn't focus on a person's momentary failure, on the bad year they had. Hebrews 11 shows us the heart of God. It focuses on their walk of faith. God doesn't focus on our momentary failures. He calls us out of that. Don't stay parked on those failures. Live by faith. So what a great example to us of how God gives all of his children a future in walking by faith. Doesn't matter what misstep you've had. Isn't that a blessing? We could stop right there and really go to prayer and ask the Holy Spirit to apply that to us and go home. Y'all want to do that? We could. That's enough of a message right there. That's enough. Please ponder that. God does not evaluate you by the bad year you had. He's evaluating you if you are going to spend the rest of your years walking by faith. That's the gospel. That is the call of God's forgiveness through Jesus Christ and his graciousness to give us all a beautiful future. Think on that. And that's why we're spending so much time in this chapter. Well, notice our theme of Hebrews 11, verse 6 is the theme of this chapter. Without faith, it is what? Impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. I hope you have that verse memorized. And remember, God says, believe that I exist and believe that I reward people who diligently pursue me. I reward them every time. He is faithful. He'll reward us. So this morning we'll be looking at Moses' faith, and probably next week too. I'm quite sure actually we'll, unless the Lord redirects, we're going to look at verses 24 to 26 this morning. And next week, we want to look at how Moses' faith, it went from personal and private decisions he made. We're looking at that. And then God gave him a public ministry after he had made many personal, private decisions of faith. He had a public ministry in verse 27 and on through verse 29. Maybe we'll do that next week. So Moses' faith, verse 24. By faith, Moses, when he became of age, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he looked to the reward. So we see here, first of all, that Moses learned to refuse. He refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. What is this? You know, to the world, they might see that action and think this was just sheer ingratitude. Moses' family was poor. They were impoverished. They were enslaved. Moses was not even supposed to be alive. If you remember, for him to be alive, they had to put him in a basket. And Pharaoh's daughter picked him up out of the river, if you remember. And she raised that Hebrew child that was supposed to be infanticide. The babies were supposed to have died, the males, at that time in history. Pharaoh's daughter kept Moses alive, and yet he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Is this just sheer ingratitude? What was he did not accept the values of Egypt. As a matter of fact, he rejected the teachings that were being imposed upon him from the schools of Egypt. He disregarded the home that had taken him in. He refused what was ungodly. You know, Moses refused several things. He refused a privileged life, if you think about it. He was Pharaoh's daughter's adopted son, and surely he had a life of rather ease and luxury. He would have had toys that the other children didn't have. He would have had the perks that only come for the wealthy. He refused a privileged life. He refused a prestigious life. When Moses became of age, what age was that? It's a little older than you and I think. But he refused to continue to consent to this prestigious life. You see, one secular historian named Josephus, he writes about this thought. He theorizes that Moses was being groomed to be the ambassador to the Hebrew people. Who better? Educated in the schools of Egypt, he understood the gods of Egypt. He understood the philosophy and ideas and the values of Egypt, and he could remain under Pharaoh's thumb, and he could keep the Hebrew people under Pharaoh's thumb. It's a pretty good theory. That prestigious life, he could have been the ambassador to Israel. Thermutis, Pharaoh's daughter, gave Moses a diamond. She gave him a privileged life, a prestigious life. And yet Moses said, I would not have that. We got to get to why. Why would he not have that prestige, that fame? Moses also refused a predictable life. If you think about the pattern of what really felt stable. Well, Moses had already been educated. He already had the wealth. It would have been most sensical to stay in that pattern. But when he became of age, as a young adult, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. You know, the Apostle Paul reminds us of this concept where what the Father offers us is far more valuable and to be cherished than what the world might present us with. He said, yet indeed I count all things but loss for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord. I want to know Him and the power of His resurrection. And I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish, that I may gain Christ. Moses had to learn to refuse what was ungodly. If he did not learn to refuse the world, there would be no room for the things of God in his life. And so it is today with you and I. We have to learn to refuse by faith what the world presents to us. If we don't denounce what the world offers us, it will occupy the recesses of our mind and our heart, and there'll be no room to choose what is right for God. Well, you see, my friends, Moses refused what was ungodly. And I want to ask us why. Why did he refuse to be called the son of Pharaoh? Is this the greatest illustration of ingratitude that we've perhaps have ever seen? Maybe it was unabated nationalism. Moses was just passionate about his country. Really had little to do with God Almighty. Really had little to do with the gospel of Jesus Christ coming out of the people of Israel. What do you think? Why did Moses refuse to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter? Was it unabated nationalism? Was it just sheer ingratitude? Or did it have everything to do with his faith? Let the Bible answer the question. Look at verse 24 again. By faith, Moses, when he became of age, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Please don't tell me that faith is an abstract concept that has little touch with reality. I tell you, it touches all our decisions. It was by faith that Moses said, I know what God has said to my forefather Abraham, and he promised Abraham a seed, an offspring, and that that offspring would produce a nation, and that nation would be given a land, and that that nation would bless all families of the earth. And I know God said that to Abraham. And look at verse number 20 of the faith chapter. Look at it. Whose name is mentioned in verse 20? Isaac. And Isaac, he blessed Jacob. Who's mentioned in verse 21? Jacob. And then who's mentioned in verse number 22 of the faith chapter? It is Joseph. Joseph, when he was dying, made mention of the departure out of Egypt of the children of Israel, and he gave instruction concerning his bones. My friends, there's the context. Moses said, I believe the words of God, and I'm acting on it, and I reject the values of Egypt. That is faith. Faith is far less about your emotion, and it is far more about the revelation God has given. You see, Moses believed God's words, and he acted on it. And somehow those Sunday school lessons that his mother and father and his sister has taught Moses, they were employed to help raise him, if you remember, although he was in the household of Thermutis, a Pharaoh's daughter. But those Sunday school lessons that Moses had been taught and that interaction with Moses' heritage, the truth of God had rooted. This man had been born in the family of God, and he had faith that would cause him to refuse the prestige, refuse the privilege, refuse an easy, predictable life, and instead line up with the people of God. I would ask you today, what is your faith causing you? What is your faith compelling you to refuse? I said it a few minutes ago. And I remember watching John Hagee a few years ago, and he got red in the face, and he got on one of his little tantrums. And you know who John Hagee is, right? He's a little shorter than me, and he's a little broader than me. And he was pumped up, and he said, my friend, if you don't denounce sin, I want to tell you, it's the Christian life, sin's going to reach up and denounce you. If you don't refuse the world is going to rise up and it's going to occupy you. My friend, we are called out of all that mess. We are in the world, but not of the world. This is not our home. We are just a passing through. I want to tell you right now, the flesh will never be satisfied. Got to rise up and you got to say no to the privileges, no to the prestige and the fame, no to what's so easy. You got to say no so there's some room to say yes to the things of God. And the Bible teaches us this again and again. Moses refused by faith. He believed the words of God. And he believed the promises of God, and he was acting on it. So I'm asking us, take a deep breath, and y'all need to calm down a little. We're coming of age, spiritually speaking. When we come of age, we have to learn to refuse what's ungodly. It's an active choice that goes on. What has your faith caused you to refuse? I want to give a little illustration here. I hope you connect with it. Hope it seems relevant. When I was a student at Tennessee Temple University, I chose to go to Tennessee Temple University because I thought I could obey the rules and thought I could agree with the balance they seemed to have at that time on applying God's word to conduct. Tennessee Temple University did not disallow going to a movie theater, but they did disallow going out on single dates. Okay? Tennessee Temple didn't disallow ladies wearing pants, but they did disallow that they have to jump out of their dorm room balcony to get the pants on. You know? So, you know, and I remember sizing up. I read Bob Jones University's credentials for going to school. I read Pensacola. This is a true story. I read Pensacola Christian College, their credentials for going and living on their campus. I read Tennessee Temple. There were several other schools. And when it all came out, I said, you know, as a young man of 19, I agree with this. I believe this is the right application of God's word. And I went to Tennessee Temple University. And there was something there on campus that was present at that time, and it was called a TV. Now, I'm hoping this will sensitize our conscience. So there I am, my first year of ministry training in 1989, and I'm on campus, and there's a TV. And every dorm had a TV. And guess where it was put? It was put in the lobby of a five-story dorm. Here's the guy's dorm, and there's the TV. And here's the girl's dorm, and there's a TV. And that was the only TV in the building. It was a TV. Did I say that already? And I can't tell you how many times in the course of my tenure at Tennessee Temple University, we're watching something and a sitcom gets going sideways, or and the swear words start flying, or the implied meanings get sensual, and the resident assistant monitoring the lobby at that time would get up and go over and turn the TV off, and all us guys would go, "Ugh, why? We're about to see the punchline." It was a TV. I'm trying to illustrate, if we don't learn to refuse the world, there will be no spot, no brain cells left in our head to be able to say yes to the things of God. This thing, every one of our young people have it. And as you know, this goes way beyond. Man, if it wouldn't cost me so much, I'd slam it against that wall. This thing is cursed. What it shows our kids, what it teaches our kids, it goes on and on and on and on. And we had enough sense in Bible college to understand that a TV needed monitoring. And our kids have this stuff nonstop. There is no doubt why culture's changing fast. Our kids have not been protected. I have plenty of regrets in this area, and I'm asking you, we all need to think a little different. We need to be careful. Because our kids, if they can't learn as young people, when they become of age, to refuse what the world will fill them up with, their cup will be full, and they'll have no room to choose for God. So, that's our first point. Moses chose to refuse what was ungodly. And this was a private decision, and I want you to catch this, because next week we're going to realize Moses made some private faith-based decisions that came long before he ever got to a public ministry. And friends, many of us are in the process of God's making some private decisions in our life, and not everybody's going to know about your choice of faith, that you're believing God's promises, you're refusing to be called a certain identity. Instead, you're going to go God's way. But make those private decisions for many years before they come to full fruit and God uses you to your fullest potential. So Moses refused what was ungodly. He chose what was godly. In verse number 25, isn't that what the text says? Choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin for a season. Now, sin has pleasure. Anybody in here, I don't think too many would want to disagree that sin has a pleasure season. Passing pleasure. The pleasures of sin are for a season, it says in the epistles. Sin is pleasurable, but I think most of us in here with gray hairs could say, yes, but the consequences, when they register in, it's not pleasant. There are pleasures in sin, but they're passing pleasures. And Moses believed God's authoritative word on this matter, so he chose instead to suffer affliction with the people of God. Do you think that Christians are still called today to suffer? Are we just called to actually have comfortable lives and secure lives and everything stable until Jesus returns for us? Or are Christians called to suffer? Are we called to suffer? We are. I'll read to you from the book of Peter. See, Moses chose to identify with God's people. Are we choosing that today? Identifying with God's people. You, here comes out of Peter, you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people. That's God's thoughts of you. A chosen person, a royal priest. You are built into a holy community, a holy nation. You are his special people. You were not once a people, but now you are the people of God. Do you choose to identify with God's people? Do you choose that? You know, what does Jesus really want from us today? Moses chose to suffer affliction with those Hebrew slaves. What does Jesus really want from us today in identifying with his people? You know, I think it's this. Jesus wants us to be all in to the church. He wants us to be all in to the church. Now, what do I mean when I say that? I mean that we are interconnected. We are intertwined. We are committed. Look at the life of Jesus Christ. My friends, with the exception of being alone with his heavenly Father in worship, in communion, in oneness, and fellowship, with the exception of that exclusive time alone, Jesus loved assembling together with his flocks. He loved hanging out. And he was as intertwined with them as any minister has ever been able to get with people. He was plugged into their lives, and they were into his, and they were intertwined and inseparable. Does that describe your view of the church? Choosing to assemble together with the believers. Be all in. Let me. Have you noticed in the lobby we've got three words on the wall out there? What are those three words? Have you noticed those? How about recall them out loud? Anybody knows what they are? What's the first one? Belong. What's that second word? Nobody's seen these? Okay, I'm going to review it from the... Okay, class, here we go. Here's lesson number one. Out in our lobbies, both our lobbies here and there, we put some words on the wall months and months ago. And thanks, Sharon Holcomb, for helping see this come to pass. Belong, grow, and serve. And what are we conveying in those words? We're talking about choosing to associate with God's people. Everybody needs a worship family to belong to. Everybody needs a spiritual family to belong to. We're asking you to worship with us, to belong. Do you feel like you belong here this morning? Do you want to know that you belong here this morning? Do you want the other people in the room to know that they belong? We belong together. We want everyone to know they belong here. We're a family. We're here to worship together. But the second word says grow. And in that, we're trying to say, go deeper with your Father through the Lord Jesus Christ. Grow deeper with God and grow deeper with others. You know, that's right out of the Bible, that we're to grow in favor with God and man. As we grow in favor with God, we will have the right foundation to grow in favor with man. Grow deeper with God and others. So we're saying, not only come and belong here and adore the Lord with us and worship with us, we belong to Him. Let's worship Him. But we've got to grow. We don't want to stay the way we are. Grow deeper with God and grow deeper with others. Now, here's the catch. Have you been coming into this sanctuary on 10:30 only and you sat down and the only people you know are the people on your row? I don't know that you're going to get the growth potential that Elkview Baptist Church has to offer. Because to grow deeper with God, my friend, you're going to have to be able to open up and grow deeper with others. I mean, I'm telling you, that's just the way God's wired us. You look at the apostles. You look at how they rubbed off and how they sharpened each other and how they interacted and challenged each other. And I'm asking for you to join a small group. That's how we grow deeper with God and with others, is we get into a small group that knows our name, knows our prayer requests. We become transparent with that group, and that group shares with us. And you know what? We challenge each other. Yeah, there's a little bit of a push and shove going on there, but it's in a positive way going forward. Anybody out there doesn't need any encouragement? Small group. Belong to the church and worship. Grow. Go deeper with God and deeper with others. Join a small group. And then serve. The word serve is out there on the walls because we're talking about, we were trying to send a message to people as they walk in here. This church has an agenda for your family. We want you worshiping. We want you connecting and growing deeper with the Lord and intertwined with us, and then we want you serving. You know, offering your gifts and abilities to bless others. That's what we're here for. We're here to glorify Him, love Him supremely, serve others selflessly. That's it. That's the mission. Love Him supremely, serve others selflessly. That goes hand in hand with go therefore and make disciples of every nation. The great commandment is the attitude in which we do the great commission. We love Him supremely. We love and serve others selflessly. So I'm asking, if everybody in the church contributed the time you contribute, would the church be healthy? If everybody in the church contributed the talent that you contribute, the talent, the gifts, your abilities, would the church be healthy? If everybody in the church contributed the treasure, the tithes, the monetary gifts that you contribute, would the church be healthy? Moses refused what was ungodly, and it opened his life up, and he was able to choose what was godly. You know, it says that he chose to suffer with God's people, and he identified with them. You know, it is so much better And so much more valuable to identify with God's people than to sing in concert with the world. I tell this story again. I know I've used it in this pulpit a couple of times, but it was so impactful in my life. In the fall of 1990, while I was a student at Tennessee Temple, I met 22 Romanian students. And these 22 students had come from the towns of Timisoara and Budapest, Romania. If you remember, just 1 year earlier, in 1989, hundreds had died in those cities in the Romanian Revolution. And one of these students I got to know quite well, his name was Daniel. He recounted the day that he watched his pastor walk before a rolling tank and open up his shirt in front of the tank. And he received a bullet and died. And that bullet, he took a bullet for human rights. He took a bullet for the religious freedoms that God intends every human being to have. Daniel's pastor became one of 1,104 deaths in the Romanian Revolution that purchased a new system of government for Romania. Wow. He suffered for the people of God. Moses was called to suffer with the people of God. You and I are chosen, and we are called to suffer with Christ because this isn't our home. So we refuse what's ungodly, we choose what is godly. And why could Moses do that? Because he esteemed the right person. If you'll notice, verse 26, esteeming the reproaches of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt. For he looked to the reward. Moses, he had calculated in his mind. He esteemed something. He considered it. He thought about it. This, what he esteemed was leading his thought processes. It was truly what he elevated. He esteemed that Christ's rewards were going to be better than anything Egypt could ever offer. He esteemed Christ above what the world was offering. You know, faith is living your life in a way that demonstrates your certainty of unseen spiritual realities. You go back to verse number one and you find that poetic description of faith. And remember, it's in but I think it's really saying is faith is we live our life in a way that demonstrates certainty of unseen spiritual realities. Moses esteemed the promised land that Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and Joseph talked about. He esteemed the promised land better than Egypt, even though he hadn't been there. Moses expected the community of God's people, that group of 12 nations, would bless the whole world. Moses valued that more than he valued his own fame and prestige. Moses believed that God's a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. So I'm asking you this morning, what do you value? What do you esteem? What are you really looking forward to? What stage have you come of age spiritually? What are you really looking forward to? You know, bow season's right around the corner. God willing, I'm going to be in the woods tomorrow. And I'm going to be cutting brush and trimming tree limbs, and I'm going to be setting a third stand. I got three ambush sites. Man, they're great. I'd be afraid to be a deer over there on Slaughter's Creek. I've put tactic into this. I've got strategy. I've thought this thing through. What do you esteem? What do you value? Do you esteem The world mocks and scoffs at a righteous life that Christ calls for. He became sin who knew no sin so that we could become the holiness of God. The world mocks and reproaches Christ, but will you value that more than? these allurements of the world? What are you really looking forward to? I would ask you to think about this. If your checkbook was analyzed today, Jesus said, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Something about what you value can be seen in your money trail. If you would take your daily planner, and I have this lovely daily planner, and it's got 7 days in the week, and then I've got the month at a glance, and if you were to look through the pages of your daily planner and see what eats your time, you're going to see a direct link to what you value and esteem. Would you all stand together, please, as we get ready to close? Moses led a privileged life, and he came of age. And he made some calculations. He said, what the world is offering me cannot compare to the promises God has assured me of. And he chose wisely. By faith, he refused. By faith, he chose. And it's because he was esteeming. He was esteeming Christ. Our Father, as we just pause and allow a moment for reflection, a moment for response, Lord, we would just ask you move in your children's hearts. Moses' choice was a choice of faith. And then the amazing grace of God came to empower that choice of faith. If there's anyone here today, Father, living in the past, thinking about a mistake that they made, help them to know, Father, that you are looking for a life of faith from this day forward. Deliver them from that bondage to the past. Their heads bowed, our eyes are closed. God's people are praying. If you've got a burden on your heart this morning and you want to pray with someone, pastors are here at the front. Just take a moment. Let's God's people pray.